Every day we come into contact with countless different microorganisms, able under the right conditions to develop even fatal diseases. Yet we survive most of these encounters. At the same time, we spontaneously develop abnormal cells that can potentially generate cancers. However, they do not develop so frequently. Why does this happen? Much of the credit for this defense goes to the immune system, a complex network that largely depends on leukocytes or white blood cells, cells that are produced in the bone marrow and that reach the whole body through the bloodstream. Before analyzing the immune system, let's take a closer look to the infectious agents, that is, all those microorganisms, viruses, bacteria, fungi, and parasites that can interact with humans. Viruses are the smallest microorganisms, 5 to 100 nanometers, and are obligate intracellular pathogens. In other words, they cannot self-replicate, but to do so, they need the organelles of a host cell. They can kill cells directly, direct cytopathic effect, or induce an immune response that kills the infected cell, indirect cytopathic effect. Larger than viruses are some intracellular bacteria, such as mycobacteria, a class the etiological agent of tuberculosis belongs to, as well as some intracellular parasites, such as the plasmodium response for malaria. They can kill the infected cell either directly or through the production of toxins. Moving up the scale, we find extracellular bacteria and fungi, which grow outside the cells, where they release toxins that are harmful to the body. Finally, larger parasites such as worms or helminths act by damaging the tissue they infect by forming and depositing cysts inside it. However, the relationship that infectious agents establish with humans is not always harmful. Depending on their relationship, they can behave as pathogens or commensals. Pathogens are harmful microorganisms which as such stimulate an immune response aimed at removing them. Commensals, on the other hand, coexist with the human being in certain areas of the body, intestine, skin, conjunctiva, oral cavity, without causing any disease, but rather benefit. Finally, there are the symbionts, which help our organism in certain processes, digestion of nutrients, development of mucosal immunity, etc. The collection of these non-pathogenic bacteria is called the microbiota, and certainly the intestinal microbiota is the most important and the most studied. Note that a commensal microorganism can act as a pathogen if certain conditions favour it. Take for example Clostridium difficile, a commensal bacterium of the intestine. As a result of taking antimicrobial therapies that alter the composition of the intestinal microbiota, it can take over and multiply dramatically, resulting in a pathology known as pseudomembranous colitis. Let's now go back to the immune system, or more simply, immunity. Immunity is a complex network of biological responses involving both immune cells, the white blood cells, but also non-immune cells and various mediators soluble in biological fluids. From a very general point of view, we can talk about innate immunity and adaptive immunity. The first one acts promptly, mounting an immediate non-specific response to counter the pathogen as quickly as possible. In the meantime, if the innate systems are not sufficient, adaptive immunity takes over, for which innate immunity prepares the field. Adaptive immunity therefore takes a few hours, but is pathogen specific and can last for weeks. Finally, at the end of the infection, certain cells of the immune system form the immunological memory, which can last for the individual's entire life and enables the subject to mount a more rapid and effective response in the event of a re-encounter with the pathogen. Vaccines, which are important tools for preventing infectious diseases, are based on a concept of immunological memory. However, remember that this distinction between innate and adaptive immunity, although very useful for those approaching the subject for the first time, is, however, for clarity purposes, and that the two actually intersect, overlap, and above all influence each other at several points. As mentioned above, innate immunity includes all of those very primordial and ancestral systems that are able to give a very general and non-specific, that is similar to different pathogens, response to a pathogen. Despite its unspecificity, innate immunity is crucial for at least two reasons. One, it provides an initial response while waiting for specific adaptive immunity to be involved. Two, it prepares the field for the action of the adaptive immunity and supports it in various ways that we will analyze. The first real mechanism of innate immunity involves anatomical and physical barriers, such as the skin or mucous membranes, which prevent the entry of pathogens. This is part of the body's prevention strategy, which aims to prevent the entry of pathogens. Once the prevention mechanism has been bypassed, the body puts in place a strategy of resistance to the pathogens trying to kill them. This process first involves preformed systems of innate immunity, such as antimicrobial peptides, normally present in human tissues, or the complement system, a set of 30 soluble proteins in the blood that help the body recognize and kill bacteria. In parallel, cells of innate immunity are activated, which step in to help eliminate the pathogen and to take action if the preformed systems are unable to solve the problem. Let's take a closer look at the cells of innate immunity. White blood cells are the main cells for the immune system. They are a large family of cells, widely different in form and function, but all derived from a single pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell. This cell, in turn, gives a rise to a common myeloid progenitor and a common lymphoid progenitor. Most, but not all, of the cells of innate immunity originate from the common myeloid progenitor. Granulocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, monocytes, from which some macrophages originate, mast cells, and most dendritic cells. The common lymphoid progenitor, on the other hand, gives rise to lymphocytes B and T, which we will examine in adaptive immunity, and to innate lymphoid cells, ILCs, which include natural killer NK cells, which play a role in innate immunity. Here too, it is important to clarify. Talking about cells of innate immunity and cells of adaptive immunity is a simplification, and each of these cells affects both types of immunity to a different degree. Before analyzing the myeloid cells of innate immunity, two basic definitions must be clarified: the concept of phagocyte and the concept of antigen-presenting cell. A phagocyte is a cell whose main function is to endocyte pathogens or their components in order to degrade and destroy them. An antigen-presenting cell, APC, is a cell whose main function is to internalize pathogen components in order to expose them on the membrane and stimulate lymphocyte activation. APCs are therefore essential for initiating the adaptive response. The exposed components are called antigens because they are able to generate an adaptive response. Phagocytes and APCs are not two distinct groups of cells, and this seems fairly obvious. A cell that phagocytes a pathogen may expose some of its components to activate immunity. However, as we will see, some cells are specialized to perform preferentially the activity of phagocytosis, while others act essentially as APCs. With this distinction in mind, among the cells derived from the common myeloid progenitor and important for innate immunity, we find macrophages, granulocytes, mast cells, dendritic cells. Macrophages are ubiquitous cells, present in all tissues of the body. They can reach tissues either during embryonic development or differentiate into macrophages from blood monocytes once they reach the tissue. They are long-lived cells and are essentially phagocytes. They are also crucial in the organization of innate and adaptive responses. Granulocytes, also called polymorphonuclear granulocytes because of their lobulated nucleus, take on different names depending on the color of the granules when prepared with common histochemical dyes. Neutrophils are certainly the most important and numerous of the granulocytes. Unlike macrophages, they live only a few days, but they too perform essentially phagocyte functions and are particularly important for responses against bacteria. Eosinophils and basophils are, on the other hand, together with mast cells, which are part of a different group, cells that play a minor role in antibacterial defense, while they are essential in allergic and parasite responses. Dendritic cells, so-called because of the numerous branches of their cytoplasm, are the most recent cells to have been discovered. They are also phagocytes and carry out abundant macropinocytosis, that is, reabsorption of tissue into stitchial fluid to detect pathogens and their components. Dendritic cells are the most important APCs, able to effectively activate T lymphocytes and trigger adaptive responses. Although primarily involved in adaptive responses, lymphoid cells also include innate lymphoid cells, ILCs, lymphocytes that are unable to specifically recognize an antigen, but have an innate action. The best known of ILCs are the natural killer NK cells, very big cells that are crucial in the innate response against viruses. How do these cells recognize a wide range of pathogens in spite of their non-specificity? This recognition is possible because these cells have, during their evolution, selected receptors able to recognize molecular structures or patterns that are typical of most bacteria. For example, the lipopolysaccharide LPS of the bacteria wall is non-specific to just one type of bacterium, but to a whole class of very different bacteria. These receptors are called pattern recognition receptors, PRRs, and are present at various levels in the cells mentioned above, in the membrane, cytoplasm, intracellular vesicles, etc. PPRs are able to recognize pathogen-associated molecular patterns, PAMPs, including LPS, but also a wide network of other microbial patterns that we will discuss later. In addition, PRRs are also able to recognize damage-associated molecular patterns, DAMPs, that is typically intracellular molecules, which, if released externally, indicate cellular damage, for example, the ATP molecule. Once activated, these receptors trigger a response in the cell that leads to two effects. 1. If possible, killing and removal of the stimulus. 2. Release of mediators that are responsible for propagating and supporting the immune response. To perform the latter function, cells of innate immunity produce cytokines, that is, proteins able to influence the action of other cells, immune and non-immune. Cytokines are responsible, for example, for the retraction of endothelial cells during an infection. With an increased permeability of the vessels and a greater outflow of the white blood cells into the tissues to fight the infection. Among cytokines, we find a particular category, chemokines, a class of about 50 elements able to attract specific cellular elements to a site in order to amplify the immune response. Innate immunity cells, cytokines, chemokines, and other mediators present in the entry site of the pathogen lead to changes in the microenvironment, often referred to as inflammation. Inflammation is characterized by four clinical features: calor, dolor, rubor, tumor, that is heat, pain, redness, and swelling. Since these four conditions are often largely determined by neutrophils and monocytes, they are often referred to as inflammatory cells. In conclusion, the immune system is made up of both innate and adaptive mechanisms. Innate mechanisms involve both cells and soluble mediators, with the ultimate goal of creating inflammation and preparing the field for adaptive immunity.
Thank you for watching. This video was created by School of Biomedical Sciences Agora. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're curious or have any doubt or question, please feel free to leave a comment below. If you want to find out more about us or want to support our project, click on the following link to visit our website.